know that Richard has some power in the material, and you do, and Peter does. So what's going to happen is, are you going to go down? Okay. Do you want to get your choices?
And in particular, equality, liberty, and the rule of law.
And so I can't even thank Amelia and the staff at General Assembly enough. I had to finagle our way in because she said, I don't know how fake news might fit in with the tech industry and our classes. And I said, we're going to make it fit. But I do believe that the way we engage with news and this new phenomenon of fake news, whatever it is, and we're going to be learning more tonight, I really believe that there was no better place, frankly, to have that conversation than here. Because how the digital era affects us and how we engage with those types of platforms is all of what General Assembly was created to talk about and teach people to learn how to use. And so I want to thank General Assembly. I also want to thank our co-sponsors who helped make tonight possible, and that is the Georgia First Amendment Foundation and Jones Day. So with that, I was only charged with one thing tonight, aside from getting here, which I barely did, and I know most of you barely did because of Emory. I want to introduce our moderator extraordinaire, Peter Canfield. One of the ladies, say hi. As we were brainstorming this event, it was truly an honor that Peter was willing to join us with ACS and to brainstorm with us what types of topics we could discuss with this amazing panel of experts. So Peter is a partner resident at Jones Day here in Atlanta. He has a very long history as an attorney, specializing as an expert in First Amendment law, in free speech, in privacy, and media. And so I can't say enough, it is the greatest honor that we got him. Peter, thank you for your time, and thank you for your brain tonight. Because you are just our rock star. And with that, I will turn it over. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nora. Can anyone hear this microphone? Does that help at all? Good, good. I'm gonna try and use it so everybody can hear me. I appreciate the invitation to be here tonight. My job is actually a very easy one, which is to just try to set the stage for a great panel to help us try and better understand the issue of fake news, what it is, how we got here, if there's a way to get out of here. And I thought I would just start by trying to set the subject a little bit, try and distinguish between a few different kinds of things that get called fake news today. Now, there's always been something called fake news. It's not new. We've had fake news for a long time. I think what has tended to happen recently is it's become more political. And I think...
Wait, you didn't endorse that?
Oh, no.
And in particular, as we saw in this last election, and even since, it has become sort of weaponized. It's gotten much more sophisticated, and the distribution mechanism for it has gotten much more advanced. So it's possible to get stories out there that are clearly fake, but that get widely distributed very quickly and get a reaction. An example, just this year after the U.S. election was in the French election, when just before the last presidential debate, a story surfaced that Emmanuel Macron supposedly had some offshore bank accounts. Turned out to be totally false, but it came up, he was asked about it during a debate, the election was 2 or 3 days later. Didn't seem to affect the outcome, but that seemed to be clearly its intent. Another issue that we've seen more and more of is websites that look like news sites, but really aren't. This is an example of one of the websites that helped put out this news about Emmanuel Macron, for example. Here's another one. And here's another one. All these popped up within, overnight. This one purports to be an interview with an expert about how these fake documents really looked real. And it's from gotnews.com, whatever that is. Much of that news was put out immediately and tweeted and retweeted by Jack Posobiec and his Rebel News site, which also happened to be the same entity that helped get the Pizzagate affair going. Just today we had an example, or I learned another example of a site that looks like a news site, but really isn't. This is, this got some attention today. It's the Free Telegraph. Well, the Free Telegraph is actually, it's a website that's produced by the Republican Governors Association. It has stories about various governors, many of them negative about Democratic governors. You wouldn't be surprised to learn. If you look closely on the website, this is magnified down at the bottom. You can see that there is, under the privacy policy, an indication that it is put out by the Republican Governors Association. But that's really about the only indication on the site. And then, of course, the other definition of fake news, or the other usage these days, is people calling legitimate news fake news. And we've seen that again and again, not just from the president, for whom that's become the standard label for CNN, but from other public officials, too. When a story comes out they don't like, it's fake news, even though it's a story that I think most of us would consider having come from a legitimate, objective, trying to be objective news service. So, what do we do about this? Let me briefly introduce the panel. You should each have four biographies in front of you. But we have a great group to talk to us about what the problem is with all these various things about fake news. The problem, as I see it, is they all tend to blur our collective sense of what is really going on in the world. It becomes more and more difficult to understand what the real facts are, and it becomes much easier to become embroiled in disputes about really illusory things. So we spend more of our less of our attention on constructive approaches to our problems, and more of our attention on discovering what's fake, what's real, etc. To try and address how we, what we should do about this, our panel of experts consists of first, and I'm going to introduce them in the order in which I'm going to call upon them to speak. Richard Griffiths, a long time, only very recently retired senior editorial director for CNN. Now the professional in residence at the University of North Carolina School of Media and Journalism. We'll next hear from Alan Abramowitz, an Emory political scientist and one of the nation's leading election forecasters. Then we're very pleased to have with us Nasenga Burton. She is a media scholar, an award-winning professor and blogger. In addition to many other achievements, she serves as editor-at-large for The Root and chairs the Department of Mass Media Arts at Clark Atlanta. To my left is Rohit Malhotra, a social entrepreneur and community organizer. He's now the founder and executive director of the Center for Civic Innovation and a judge and longtime First Amendment lawyer, Holly Mannheimer. Holly served for many years as the executive director of one of the sponsors tonight, the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, and she is now a DeKalb magistrate judge. Uh, to our panelists to play doctor for us tonight, starting with you, Dr. Griffiths. We're all sick of fake news. We're sick of being sick of fake news. What's your diagnosis and what's your prescription?
It's not fatal. In fact, it's been around a long time. I'm going to read a little quote here. Nothing can now be believed which is seen in a newspaper. Truth itself becomes suspicious by being put into that polluted vehicle. That was Thomas Jefferson. Yeah. Right? I mean, there was a time where the printed press came along and all these broadsheets came out and all of this rubbish was printed and published and put out there. And all these politicians were dealing with these broadsheets and these flyers that went out. The difference is that today, the stuff that's being published, you saw it here on the screen, looks so similar to legitimate sites. What was a broadsheet with limited circulation, perhaps of 500 or 1,000 copies in one city, is now seen globally by tens of thousands of people. And it gets forwarded to you by your mother-in-law and by your cousin Vinny. And with that comes the imprimatur of the credibility of your relative. I want to look at this on a global perspective, and if I can go to the
fast forward to my
There we go. So Edelman does a public relations survey every year. It's an amazing, amazing survey. They survey 22,000 people worldwide, which gives them a margin of error of 0.6% globally. That's a really, really good survey. And what they've found is that trust in all the four major institutions, NGOs, business, government, globally, all dropping, but media dropping the most, down 5 points last year to this year. That is a huge fall off the cliff. If I'm Dr. Griffiths, this is the diagnosis that you get from the MRI when you're thinking, we need to have a private chat. Right? This is tough. If you look at it, all across the globe, trust in media almost universally is below 50%. Distrust in 82% of the countries. Fascinating for me, because I worked at CNN for so long, and I don't know whether this is because of CNN or because CNN's management are incredibly smart, is that the countries where trust in media is improving, Turkey, Sweden, India, and Indonesia, are all countries where CNN has launched partner broadcasters or partner news platforms where they've brought in really high journalism standards and generally raised the quality of journalism in those countries with a trusted brand. Whether that's a coincidence or whether that is perhaps a part of that brand identity where they make big splash, I'm not clear, but there's some small chunks. Still, only 25% of Turks trust the media. Right? Those numbers are still really, really tiny. In Sweden, up 2% with Aftonbladet joining as a CNN partner. 33% trust in the media. Still pretty dismal. And if you look at which forms of media fall in, traditional media shows the steepest decline. You've got the biggest trust is in search engines, which is actually up. People trust Google and Bing more than they trust CNN and the New York Times. That's scary, frankly. And then this is a huge issue here. This is between what I would call the mass population, the educated, informed public. You would probably, everybody here would probably be in the informed public group, at which globally 60% trust the media institutions, whereas the mass population, only 45% trust So a big gap between the educated and the less educated. Finally, this says it all, Michael Gove. I don't think I can do a good Michael Gove accent, but I can try. People in this country have had enough of experts. Right? This is the situation. The most critical are people like yourself. Your mother-in-law, your cousin Vinny. And then down here, the government official, boards of directors, CEOs, financial industry analysts, employees, academic experts, they're down 5 points, sorry. You can trust them, really. But this is the scary scenario that we're seeing, where you have an environment where the junk is flying around. It looks like legitimate stuff, and it's coming to you from people you trust. And that's the underlying issue that we're facing. Just this one more example that just continues to drive me crazy. This is from the day of the election. Excuse me, this is November 8th. Election day. And this was, Nevada poll workers were caught breaking the law today. Several of the poll workers in the CNN report were wearing defeat Trump t-shirts. And we were getting harassed in the ground in Nevada by people. Why aren't you reporting this? This was hundreds of thousands of retweets and shares. The problem was that this was a story done by one of our reporters the Friday before the election, and these were actually Clinton workers in a Clinton boiler room making calls to get out the vote. And so it was completely repurposed. This organization, Gateway Pundit, now has a place in the White House press room. So that gives you some idea of what kind of crisis we're now facing. So some of it we brought on ourselves. As an industry, we've failed to adjust to the new technologies. Newspapers have been slow. I would include CNN in being slow. I would include many organizations in being slow. And CNN's been on the cutting edge of dealing with so much of this technological change. We've been arrogant about acknowledging and correcting our mistakes. I'm proud to say at CNN we were open and transparent about our screw-ups, and God knows there were plenty of my tenure. If you look at others, you look at Fox News, for example, I have to call them out here. It took a lawsuit to get them to correct their last big screw-up. We have not, as an industry, been sufficiently clear about our journalistic processes and how we get to produce the particular stories, how we gather the news in a way that you as an audience can understand and trust.
How we filter it,
how we build things out. By the way, this is the amazing Bob Fernand with us tonight, the extraordinary senior executive producer and vice president of CNN during his glory years of development, a giant in the industry. It's really happy.
Here's the smart one.
We've not been sufficiently clear about what is reporting, opinion, and analysis. And a small thing is, who can explain to me what a ragged right edge in a story in the New York Times means? Anybody know what that means on the website, where it's got a ragged edge as opposed to a justified edge? Oh, that's an analysis piece. Or it might, right? So it's hard to pick that stuff out. They mark it, and they give you clues, but you have to know and be able to decode it. And we're not doing enough to make it truly clear the difference between an analysis piece, an opinion piece, and straight reporting. And so often on so many websites, the lead story will be an analysis piece. So you'll have a big breaking news story, and then you'll have analysis, and you're saying, well, you're taking the president to task. We haven't even heard what he said yet. So the sum of that is an issue for our industry. And I don't think we have fought back adequately against the fake news monster. We've not done enough, in my view, to call out the crappy work, the fake stories, and publish knockdowns of those stories. And that, frankly, requires a lot of resources. And if you're pedaling the bicycle as fast as you can to get down the road covering the news of the day in your community, diverting resources to go look at somebody else's work is very expensive, very hard, but I think we have to do it, and we have to figure out how to do it well. So one more thing from Jefferson. Were it left to me to decide whether we should have a government without newspapers or newspapers without a government, I should not hesitate a moment to prefer the latter.
My version of Rocket Man. I was thinking about doing that. For reasons that you probably understand. So, I want to talk a little bit. I study American politics, especially public opinion, elections, and voting. So, as you might imagine, I've been very busy since November 8th. And I've been very busy. Part of that has involved explaining to people why I got it wrong, like almost everyone else. So even though my forecasting model is a great job, why my prediction was wrong, like almost everyone else. And it has something to do with the difference between the popular vote and the electoral vote and all of that. But I've also been very busy trying to understand not only what happened on November 8th, but what's been happening ever since then. And so this topic is very much something I've been very interested in and concerned about, fake news. And one of the things that I am very interested in and studied and written about is the phenomenon of partisan polarization. And that is this growing divide between our two parties. Growing divide not only between what they stand for, their ideologies, but also between the kinds of people who support the two parties, and a growing divide in terms of how we look at those on the other side. And I think this has a lot to do, this phenomenon of partisan polarization, I think, has a lot to do with fake news and the reasons why fake news works, why it has actually had significant impact on the American public. And that is that, and the first thing you have to understand is that Americans' attitudes about the news media are deeply divided along partisan lines. Democrats and Republicans nowadays, this was not true 30 or 40 years ago, we have very different views of the media. Okay,
so skip something there.
So this is some data from the Gallup poll on how Americans view the accuracy of the news media, of news media organizations, broken down by party. What you can see there is that back in the late 90s and early 2000s, there was only a fairly small divide between the way Democrats and Republicans viewed the accuracy of news organizations. But in 2017, and I guess they didn't bother asking this question for a long time, but in 2017, as you can see, percentage of respondents saying the media get the facts straight is widely divergent. 62% of Democrats, still not great, much higher than Republicans, 14%. So here's what we can. Republicans today deeply, deeply distrust the mainstream news media. And what that means as a result of that is that they are extremely susceptible to fake news. Not to say Democrats are not sometimes susceptible as well, but this deep distrust for the mainstream media means that supporters of the Republican Party today in particular are primed to believe these sorts of fake news stories when they're put forth by these non-mainstream news, media outlets and by Republican leaders and of course by President Trump. Long way, okay. When we break that down further by education, we've heard about the effect of education already. There is an effect of education, but among Republicans, even the college educated, even those with college degrees, deeply mistrust the news media organizations. Among Democrats, there's a bigger divide. Among Democrats, as you can see, there's a big divide from college. College graduates have much higher trust than those without college degrees among Democrats. Interesting. This is some data from the Pew Research Center. Overall, the majority of the public support the news media's watchdog role. This is an interesting question. Do you think that the news organizations keep political leaders from doing things that shouldn't be done, meaning they're acting as watchdogs, or that they keep political leaders from doing their job, which is what we're hearing from President Trump, right? Well, look at what happened. First of all, there was a drop. Although still 70% of Americans choose to keep political leaders from doing things that shouldn't be done. So a large majority of Americans still support the idea of the news media as watchdogs. But look what happens here at the end. In the bottom graph, Republicans are falling off the table. Only 42% of Republicans versus 89% of Democrats accept or support this sort of watchdog role. Lots of other questions here, where we see a growing partisan gap. And this is just between 2016 and 17. In just 1 year, we're seeing the divide open up in terms of belief that the media favor one side over the other, trust in the media, and belief in national news media do things very well at keeping them informed. It's growing partisan divide over this. Obviously, this is a reflection of what citizens are hearing from their political leaders. Republican leaders, especially President Trump, are repeatedly telling them they should not trust or believe what the media are telling them. And we're seeing that that is having a big effect. That by and large, rank and file Republicans, to a large degree, are accepting that claim. That's very dangerous, because it means now that it becomes almost impossible to correct this information, because they're not going to believe the correction. If the correction is coming from the mainstream media, if it's coming from fact checkers, which are part of the mainstream media, it has very little effect because the level of mistrust is so high. This ties in with another, of course, very important phenomenon, which is that there's a huge party divide now in terms of where people get their news. This is something, again, that was not true in the past. Go back to the 60s and 70s, there was very little difference in terms of where Democrats and Republicans got their news. Today, Fox News stands out as by far and away the leading source of information, if that's the right word for it, among Republicans. Whereas you can see 40% of Republicans name Fox News as their main source for news about the campaign versus 3% of Democrats. Almost no Democrats rely on Fox. Democrats have a wider array of sources that they rely on, Clinton voters, that is, versus Trump voters, CNN, MSNBC, etc. Facebook, interestingly, shows up on both lists. Obviously, Facebook just means, you know, wherever, that's doesn't tell you much, right? But there's obviously a big divergence here in terms of where people are getting their information. Now, another very important phenomenon recently, of course, has been the rise of non-traditional news sources, online news sources. People are increasingly turning to these to find information, and in most cases, it's to find information they find compatible with their own predispositions, just as with watching news on television. So we're seeing Google News, you know, that's kind of used by both. The Huffington Post, and not surprisingly, it's Clinton voters, a quarter of Clinton voters mentioned that versus only 9% of Trump voters. I'm surprised it's even 9%. Yahoo News, Breitbart. Okay. 11% of Trump voters named Breitbart as a place they regularly got news about the 2016 campaign from. Whoever looked at Breitbart,
that's kind of. How many visits did they get in a typical month?
What's that?
How many visits did Breitbart get in a typical month?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know.
I suspect it's rather small. Like
not anymore.
It's growing quite a bit, I think. Yeah. But it's very selective, so they're getting overwhelmingly from conservatives, Republicans who are going there. BuzzFeed, obviously, Drudge Report, another source that's used much more heavily on the right than the left. But the point is that there are any number of these online sources. I mean, they're just unlimited in number, but the more popular ones, in many cases, appeal to very ideologically distinctive groups. And again, people are getting reinforcement today. So I'll conclude with that and just say, I think this is a huge problem because, and my colleagues who speak Russian tell me that really does say thank you, but. because the level of mistrust across party lines, mistrust of the other party, and in the case of Republicans especially, mistrust of the media is so high. Of the mainstream media that it becomes very difficult to correct misinformation. So when we talk about the problem of fake news, in the American political context particularly, it is overwhelmingly, not exclusively, but pretty overwhelmingly an asymmetrical issue. It's primarily conservatives and Republicans who are the most likely to believe fake news. Now, not excluding Democrats or liberals by any means, I mean, it happens on both sides. But right now, because of this high level of mistrust of the mainstream media on the part of conservatives and Republicans, it is very disproportionately on one side. All right.
Do you have any statistics to show the partisan divide, when it began and when it became accelerated first? I would think it would, but we got with Spiro Agnew. Most of you are too young to know who Spiro Agnew mm-hmm. was, but his gigantic right. dump on yeah. the media began to spread, and then Fox took advantage of it.
The nattering gay bombs of negativism, which actually William Safire was the one who came up with that. But, right, this is not new, you know, as we've heard. So Republicans and conservatives have been promoting this idea that you shouldn't believe the mainstream media, that they can't be trusted for a long time. But I would say that it's gotten much worse. And the difference now is also that we have all these alternative so-called news sources and sites. And this even gets into, of course, the influence of foreign governments and role, for example, that Russia played in the 2016 election, which we're still learning about. But it's clear, I think, that certain people were much more susceptible to that sort of manipulation than others. They were targeted. It looks like there was a very careful campaign, very orchestrated campaign to target certain types of voters in the swing states, in key swing states like Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan, for these fake news stories and messages. And they figured out what kinds of people were most susceptible. Low education, you know, white voters who might be inclined to be sympathetic to those sort of messages. So it's pretty scary.
Thank you. Sanga, you live in this world, sort of online. What's your perspective?
I don't know if you're ready. fake news. So, one of the things I love that you talk about is this whole idea of ideology. Can you all hear me okay? And this is one of the things that we talk about. So I do live in this world. I'm an academic. I'm also a writer, journalist, a trained journalist, so I'm old school. I look a little older than I am, but y'all right, so I'm a trained journalist, like old school, but I'm new school in terms of technology and media. So the way that I teach my students is I train them old school, like they know how to write, they know what the lead is, you know, they know how to investigate, you know, things like that, that matter. And I always tell them that the way to be successful in the new media space and the new online space and to not to create fake news is if you take those old school values and old school skills and approaches to really data collection and news gathering and apply it in the media space. So when we talk about fake news, the reason that people are very much able, and this is what Richard was talking about, to call whatever they don't like fake news is because we aren't very transparent about the news gathering process. And you really shouldn't have to take a class in journalism or major in it to understand how the news gathering process works. So, you know, this audience, I'm assuming, is a little different. It does fit into that group that Richard talked about, and that is people that are informed, interested in the topic, and have some knowledge of what we're talking about, a little bit at least. We can assume that, we'll make that assumption. But I think it's a false assumption for us to assume that most people have some idea about how journalism works. I think we're also living in a very anti-intellectual age, and a lot of people don't, a lot of people, and these are broad generalizations, but this is what I'm finding in my research and in my reading, so I'm just talking to you, I'm having a conversation, all right? But I think in terms of anti-intellectualism, journalists were thought of as being for the state. They checked the other three branches of government. That was our charge, all right? And so now I think, especially with new media in society and the cultural shift in society and the ways in which we communicate, it's just become less and less obvious in terms of who is checking whom, right? So when we hear this data, which is very good, but when we hear this data, a lot of times we don't understand how data is gathered. We don't understand how to interpret it. So in a space, whether it's a classroom or not, when you start giving people facts, even in a journalism program, I was at Grady last year, that's at UGA, which is one of the top programs in the country. I came out of Northwestern, right? So I go back there periodically. But even in journalism programs, you see the eyes glaze over like, oh, here we go, this is that partisan stuff. And it's like, no, this is data. These are the facts. Yes, this information may not apply to you because you're not in that sample, but it doesn't mean it's not inaccurate. All right, so I think that a lot of fake news has to do with the ability to transmit fake news and for people to not understand it. They don't understand how news is gathered. They don't understand how data is collected. They don't understand the difference between editorial and reporting. And when I say they, I mean most people, including most journalism students, is what I'm finding. And so I spent a lot of my time, even in journalism programs, teaching students the difference between fake news and real news. Now, particularly when we talk about this last election, and you know, there's just not enough time. But when we talk about this last election, students, there were some that are independent, there's some that are democratic, there's some that are anti-establishment, I have students that identify as anarchists, I have students that identify as Democrats. So you have all these categories, but we only have two political parties right now, official political parties. But even in those spaces, and even though we were focusing on reporting on the election from the student perspective, there was still a lot of discussion about what information was important. So when we think about agenda setting, right, when we think about who gets to set that agenda, Fox actually has an agenda, all right? And I think that, and I hate the term, like, conservative, because as a black person in America, it's the same to us in a lot of ways. But some more liberal publications, more liberal media companies, they have an agenda. But others, I think, is great. Right, it's a gray area. You're not sure if they have an agenda. We're not sure who's setting the agenda. We're not sure how we're getting this information, who's doing the reporting, who's sent out, what are the resources, and all of these things that we think about intellectually when we're looking at these slides, when we turn on the television, and so forth and so on. So I think a lot of it is a fundamental lack of education, which is tied to a lack of transparency in how we talk about the news and how we talk about how news is gathered. So, another thing I want to talk about is ideology. Ideology is very important in the ways in which people process news. So it's not surprising that people don't want to hear the news. We are tasked with bringing people the facts, the truth. And we are tasked with removing ourselves as much as possible from the subject. Now, in some cases, it's very hard to do. Like, that's true. We're all human beings. We all have feelings. We all have thoughts, or what have you. But whether you are a researcher, like an academic, whether you are a journalist, in the same case with judges and lawyers, you are supposed to have and remove yourself from the situation, from the subject, in order to have some type of objectivity and to really report what the facts are. That's very difficult to do, particularly in a society that is deeply rooted in dominant ideologies. In dominant ideologies. Dominant ideologies, when I talk about dominant, I'm talking about the ruling class. So if we're talking about race in this country, we might be talking about wealthy whites. If we're talking about gender in this country, we might be talking about wealthy white men. If we're talking about class, you know, we might be talking about wealthy people. You know, it just depends on what the stratas are, all right? But dominant ideology suggests that the media can't be trusted. It is not new, all right? Richard talked about, I think you said broadsheets, chat books, all of the beginning, right? And all of that was new technology at one point, all right? And it was very hard to get a handle on that. But a lot of us do not know the difference between propaganda. This is how Hitler came to power. You know, this is how we had the Protestant Reformation, right? People don't know the difference between propaganda, news, information, and so you have all of these things being bombarded because we had technology to it, technological development. And I want people to remember, at one point, all of this is new technology. The typewriter was a new technology once. The printing press was new. We think of that as old. So it's not really that different. It is in terms of speed, but not in terms of concept. So when you magnify that, and you can put a story out with 140 characters, which is fabulous. I love how people use Twitter to tell stories and what have you. It's interesting, except when it's not factual. And people are like, oh, I need to make a decision based on this non-factual information that's been creatively done. So, you know, we're moving in a society that is very fast. It is still tied to those dominant ideologies about race, class, gender, sexuality, sexual identity, all of those things. And so it's easy to me as a user of media and as a creator, because you know I think we have to own that too, right? Because we're always, you know, we're distant from the subject, but we actually create, we set the agenda, we decide what's gonna be in the paper or online or what have you, like who are we gonna take, where's this gonna be, what social platforms are we gonna put it on, all right? So it's easy actually to see why people doubt media, that's not new. What is new, though, is the quickness with which traditional media and what I would call actually vetted media is dismissed. That's a problem. And that's how one of the reasons that contributes to this illness that we have. So we have many illnesses in the United States: racism, sexism, heterosexism, homophobia. You just go right on down the line. And so now we have media, which is another form of illness, the anti-intellectualism, anti-media, right? So it's like, I don't want to hear your facts. It's like, oh, but they're facts. I'm not telling you how to interpret them, right? And then it's like, oh, let me interpret these facts, you know, because that's what we're using to interpret the facts. Yeah, but they're still facts. So even if you remove the interpretation, what are the facts? Now, how you want to deal with them is up to you. Whether you want to ignore them, whether you want to accept them, whether you want to act on them, whether you want to be passive, whether you want to like fire off something on Facebook and then have a cocktail. That's the type of revolutionary. A lot of people are nowadays, they get pissed off, and they're on Facebook, and then they go have a cocktail, they go happy hour. I mean, whatever you want to do, that is what's going to work for you. But dismissing people who are actually invested in and spend their livelihoods doing this research, doing this news gathering, is problematic. It's problematic. When you have folks who have spent, I have a PhD, so let's say 12 years of graduate study, it was a lot, and it was expensive. But when you have people who have done that type of study, and people are just like, who cares what they say? He got, one election wrong in like 40. Ah, never gonna listen to him again. That's a problem. So there is an article, I'm gonna point you to some resources. 2 days ago, September 17th, 18th, I think, in the New York Times, there was an article that came out that talked about fake news. And in it, they quoted Kathleen Hall Jamison, my former dean, who's the current director of the Annenberg Public Policy Center at UPenn. And she talked about three ways that we can actually think about how to combat or deal with, because, you know, some people are okay with fake news. I'm not really okay with fake news. I live in the real world, I deal with facts. So she talked about three ways that we can combat or challenge or deal with fake news. One of which was to stop spreading fake news. And that seems like a very, like, you know, minimal thing to do. But we spent a lot of time just regurgitating fake news. Go on Facebook, go on Twitter, go on Snapchat, any other social media, Instagram. You know, how many times do you have to say, and I, you know, based on Facebook statistics, I have a very educated phone. But I have to sometimes say, oh my gosh, that's not the onion. That's actually a real story. Or, oh my gosh, that's the onion. Do you know what that is? You know what I mean? Right? So I spent a lot of time educating people about telling the difference. And a lot of that has to do with what Pete is talking about and what Richard talked about is the media. We have so many skills and technology now, which is fantastic. I love it. But we can recreate whatever we want. We can recreate the scene. Like, we can walk out of here and within an hour recreate the scene and change all of the information that came out of it. When you have that type of ability and access, it's fantastic. But it's also challenging because some people are going to use that to the detriment of society. So I think when you have these things working hand in hand, it's a problem. But she talks about, one, stop spreading the lies. Two, she also talks about being transparent, all right? Talking about the news process, telling people, like, that's what we have done as journalists. And I think part of that is because we have sources. We try to have discretion. We try to protect people. We try to protect our colleagues. All right, and so that's part of the culture. But in having that and being in this magnified society now, we have to do differently. Because if we don't change the ways in which we share information and even the news gathering process, then I think it will continue with this whole idea of, oh, you know, you can have Trump, President Trump say, oh, CNN is fake news. Okay. And then lastly, she talks about the use of video, which I love. Video, people in this generation, and it is true. And even video is good for SEO, that's just a pointer out there. But video, and that's search engine optimization, but video is good because many people now don't really want to read our fabulous writing. They don't care that we know the eight parts of speech. They don't care that we write the subject verb agreement. They don't care that we do Pulitzer Prize winning and that we like struggle and think about stories and spend years of our lives covering them and chasing them down and going overseas. They don't care. You know, it's not all people, of course, but many people don't care. But if they can see it, and this is in some cases, not in cases of police brutality necessarily, right. But in other cases, if they can see it, they will believe it. And so she says that one of the ways that we can combat this whole fake news is to actually debunk it in a visual medium, because that's how most people are engaged, or many people in, you know, a younger demographic, younger than me, are engaged in the news. And so that's one way to connect with those folks. And this is what I'll leave you with, this idea of connection. That is very foreign to media people in terms of journalists. Our goal is to stay away from you so that we can be objective, get the facts, report. All right, and there's all types of journalism. You know, long form is different. But for the most part, when we're talking about reporting, we just want facts, and so I have to remove myself. We have to now connect with people. That is why people are watching Fox. They have an agenda and they have connected with people who share the same dominant and perverted ideologies that they do. And they're very clear on it. This is who we are, this is what we do. If you are like us, watch us. Do this, vote this way, do this thing. So I'm not saying it's a good thing or a bad thing, it is what it is. That's why people watch MSNBC, and I hate to equate it to you, but MSNBC, because I'm hearing what reflects my way of thinking, right? So they're connecting with people in ways, and that's largely through editorial, and not so much through reporting, but I think that we have to really be mindful of how to connect with people. People are disconnected in a very connected world. That's the great irony, and that's a great challenge, though. I don't think it's a negative necessarily. I think it's a challenge. How do we connect with people and gain or regain their trust in this ever-increasing problematic society that really is just having a problem dealing with facts and truth as it relates to lots of different industries and different populations, and news is just not immune to that. That's it.
Good evening, everyone. How's everyone doing?
Great.
Great.
Good. I'm in a room filled with academics, and I'm the bad student that gets to sit on the side. So I'm very, very excited to be here. My name is Ravit Malhotra. I'm the founder and executive director for the Center for Civic Innovation. And I spend a lot of my time on the ground really talking to communities and dealing with the results and the consequence of fake news, and one of the ultimate consequences being a lack of trust. And what that's done inside of communities. And so I have a few points that I wanted to make. The first is that this is new. In a lot of ways, it's new. When I first started off my career, I actually was working for the One Campaign, Bono's big thing, and we were on the internet team. And it was a bunch of us that were under the age of 25 who knew how to use the internet. And so we had people coming in being like, hey, there's this dope thing going to be called Twitter. You can follow people, literally, like you can creepily just stalk the celebrity that you love, and you can get a sense of what their life is like. You should definitely try it. Could we do it with Bono, etc.? And that was the original intention in 2008 for these tools, was to connect us in a very different way that we hadn't been connected before. And so one of the first projects that we did, which was amazing, is we took all the email addresses of people who went to YouTube concerts. And as a hip hop fan, I wasn't as educated as I should have been on YouTube, but I didn't realize how many email addresses it would be. We literally, at the time, Google didn't have a function where you had a limit. We would BCC everybody, and we would send an email. We'd be like, hi, it's Bono. And I'd like you to actually speak out on this particular issue. Call your member of Congress. Here's a list of their phone numbers. And we shut down congressional lines. And you had our CEO came into the internet team's office and was like, what the hell did y'all do? Like, what were y'all doing? That's crazy. But that's awesome. Let's keep doing it. So we just kept doing it and doing it and doing it, right? And so you started to watch things like change.org and Move On and people using this petition-based service. Let's get people activated. This was new. There was a bunch of like people who just graduated from college figuring it out. And so when the president was elected, President Obama, he actually took a lot of our teammates and we became one of the first new media teams for the president. Now, that sounds glorious, but because there were not rules in place on how the president of the United States could actually communicate online, we were shoved into the basement of the DNC and told that we had to work there, but it's cool, there will be snacks, and you know how much is my snacks. So we sat there, and we would think about how does the president of the United States, how should they communicate online? This was new. The president's about to win the Nobel Prize. What do we say? All of these absurd things that had never happened before. And as an organizer, what I would do is we would message some stuff online, then I would actually go on the ground and get to know some of the constituents that we're talking to. And I kid you not, I went to one training once where a woman came up to me and she said, sir, do you work with the president? I was like, yeah, I guess technically. That's what I tell my parents. And she said, I want you to deliver a message for me. She's like, I want you to tell Michelle that I really appreciated her email last night. I think that she was just so clear, and I love when she sends those messages to me, and every time I'm responding, she's not really responding back, but I get it, she's busy. And that sounds absurd to us right now, but that was not absurd in 2008, 2009, 2010. People actually thought the President of the United States and his wife, the First Lady of the United States, were communicating with them, and we used it as a tactic. We said we could get their attention. That, therefore, we could get them to donate, we could get them to engage, we could get them to show up, we can get them to say what we want them to say, how we want them to say it. And what we used digital technology was an opportunity to remove ourselves from the reason why we were able to do that in the first place. We removed ourselves from the ground. And digital technology will never be a replacement for human interaction. And we are learning that hardly. We're learning it in a way that is destructive. Because when we went back during the midterms, we had people come and say, where'd you go? We sent you an email. I don't check my email. Where'd you go? I thought the first black president would take care of me. Where'd you go? We forgot about the human side of our work. We forgot why this stuff matters in the first place. And so, what we also learned through that process is so many people didn't actually know how to use the internet. To this day, yesterday, I kid you not, my dad texted me for the first time, right? My dad texted me, and I replied with the Steve Harvey clap it gif, where he's just clapping. My dad responded and said, "Why does he keep clapping?" And he was concerned about Steve Harvey. We forgot an entire group of people never were trained on how to use the internet. We figured it out ourselves because my immigrant parents sacrificed their own education to get me a computer to make sure I would never have to struggle, grow up with the ultimate privilege of growing up poor, not knowing I was poor. And you sit there and you realize we forgot so many people. And we're surprised that people don't, they're not gonna be able to differentiate between whether this is real or fake or whatnot because we forgot about them in the first place. We only give a shit about them when it's convenient for us. And so, I think we have to remember that media did lie. Look, I voted for President Obama, I worked for President Obama, and I may not like what everything that this president has to say, but the media lies. We have to accept that. The media portrays certain people in ways that is dangerous. The reason a kid was shot in a hoodie and was given that perception in the first place of being dangerous was not human nature, it was taught. The reason why when a person who looks like me is accused of a crime, we can call them a terrorist very quickly, but we can't do it if it looks like you. We gotta do the investigation first. We gotta be good journalists. That shit caught up. It caught up to y'all. And now you're dealing with the consequence of it. You pissed off enough people. You misportrayed enough people. Why? Because we thought data and technology was enough. But it's not. Because people are not data points. People are wrapped up in cultures and technology and feelings and traditions. My parents, who almost lost their house, were not a data point. But the media could have warned us about a housing crisis that was going to happen. But instead, after you watched headline news, you had another guy going and say, buy this stock, do this thing. My parents used to watch CNN religiously because they knew Susie Orman would come on and tell them exactly what they should do with their money. You deceived us. You told us it was okay to listen to Donald Trump when he was giving us real estate advice. Then when the housing crisis happened, you said, well, markets happen. But now we have to rebuild and repair. And we're constantly being told what we should do. So that's why we don't trust media. And so, when we talk about this stuff, we have to make sure we don't just treat people like they're crazy. They're not. They're hurt. We went through one of the greatest financial recessions ever. There's a reason why people voted for Brexit. There's a reason why people go out and behave and say the things that they say. They're hurt. And we never repaired that. Instead, we're trying to put another story to cover up the story. We've taken empathy out of this work. And we gotta bring it back. We can't just tell stories of amazing things happening on the ground in between at 2 a.m. with a segment that's sponsored by Colgate saying, no worries, look at all these amazing heroes that are going on. Tell the stories of the heroes as a part of the story that's happening every day because actually amazing things are happening on the ground each and every day. I get to see it. I get to watch ATLians who care about the city so deeply. The city that is the most unequal city in the entire United States still fight to make it better, every day. I don't know whether they're Democrats or Republicans. I know that they give a damn about their city, and I know that they want to make it better. And I know that they are not relying on the media today, especially at a local level. We are not relying on you to tell us what's actually happening. Because local media is one of our greatest losses. Because national media will continue to play to whoever's going to pay for the commercials in between. local media is by a lot of people who are reporting on what's happening right next door to them, or where they grew up, or how things are going on a day-to-day basis. And in cities, we have threatened local media so hard that we have said, if you talk out of line, we will make sure you never get coverage again. This president is not the first person to do that. We have mayors across this city, across this country. Freudian slip. We have mayors across this country who silence our media and say, if you talk bad about me, you watch what I do. To the point where when an agenda for an economic development authority gets flipped overnight, no one even knows, not even the reporters. So what's happened? We have to bring empathy back to this work. We have to empower our local journalists, and we have to take our failure vows, because this has been an imperfect journey, and it's new for us. And unless we define it, it will define us, and I think we're in a lot of trouble in that way. But I'm optimistic, because if you take your eyes off of the screen, people are still amazing, and they are still doing the work. And this work will continue to go on with or without the media. The question is do you want to be a partner or be treated as the outsider? I hope it will be the former. Thank you.
Too much, and certainly more than we have done. As a judge, My job is to find the truth. I got to get to the bottom of the dispute. And again, that echoes what all the other things I see. It's hard to get at the truth, and people don't present properly. And in my low-level courtroom disputes with people yelling at one another, it's really hard to find out what the truth is. As a citizen, I can't find the truth anymore. It's this idea that I don't know how to find it. I want to find it. And again, this fake news concept prevents me. I don't know, and I suspect many of us in this room feel the same way. But let me go to my fifth perspective, practicing law with politicians for many years. I'll never forget this. I sat down with one of my law partners a number of years ago. I won't identify who it is. He or she said to me, "You know what politics is about?" I said, "No." I said, "I don't. The art of self-promotion." And I never thought the number one job of politicians is to self-promote. And I never really thought of that until recently, because that's what we see across the political spectrum. And my dear friend is sitting in the back, Jerry Weber. We used to, I wasn't as big of an Obama fan as he was, but my point is, politics is the art of self-promotion. And that seems to me inconsistent with all the other things I raised. The first four categories were interested in truth. Politicians, less so interested in truth, and I think that's the genesis, or some of the genesis, of fake news. So I'll be brief, because we want questions. So solutions. From my role as the First Amendment Foundation Director, I say, keep using your open records law, keep pushing for transparency, keep trying to dig the facts up yourself, because we might not be able, at least for the short term, and I hope you're right, I hope it gets better, but we might not be able to count on news right now. From my role as a lawyer, all I can say is be professional, professionalism, courtesy. In my role as a judge, what I'm trying right now, for example, in my animal control cases where I get a million the same neighbors coming in asking me to solve their problems all the time about barking dogs. I'm sending them to mediation to work it out themselves in my order. So I'm saying some self-help, which kind of echoes the idea of what I'm suggesting the first in my role as a First Amendment Foundation. Let's see, what was next? As a citizen, thank you. I'm just going to try to read more, try to dig more, try to use my open record skills and just keep asking the same questions that all of us are asking here today. But lastly, I would say for the politicians, the self-promoters, if I can be so bold, I think we just got to do a better job of electing measured individuals, thoughtful individuals, and folks who do not promote this contest of fake news. Thank you.
I want to give our panelists, if any of them have any final comments before we open up for questions and comments from the audience.
It's okay to call something a lie when it's a lie. If something is an outright, a bold-faced lie, it's okay to call it an outright, bold-faced lie. It'll be okay in the morning.
So following up on that, politicians are self-promoters, absolutely true. I haven't met one yet, so. But there's still a difference, and there's different ways of doing it. So the New York Times has a continuing series in which they track Donald Trump's lies. Donald Trump has lied more often about matters small and large than any other politician in modern history, certainly than any other president. And, starting with before he became president, with Barack Obama wasn't born in this country, to Muslims celebrated on 9/11, now to millions of undocumented immigrants voting in the election and for Hillary Clinton. So you name it. I mean, the size of the crowd at his inauguration. And he repeats these lies even when he's called out for them. And his underlings often aid him and abet him in doing that. He's different, people, and we need to say that right now. And it's dangerous because it can lead to really bad decisions and bad public policy. So in the case of the voting lie, undocumented immigrants, you know, voted in large numbers. It's a total lie. Even Republican secretaries of state, including our own, said that didn't happen. But he created a commission to study the electoral process with a specific aim of making it harder for minorities and poor people to vote, using that as an excuse. Now, it may not work. The good news is that most Americans actually don't believe most of these lies. Okay? But a lot of them do. A lot of people do.
What comment am I about saying it's a lie, don't think it's a lie? You've got to be very careful when a reporter is saying something that's subjective. It seems to be, say, according to this source, and it's an academic study, or it's got some credentials to it, then I think we'd do that. But to say of our own volition, myself as a reporter going to tell you this is a lie. Well, it's like saying something's a miracle. What's a miracle to Richard is different than what's a miracle to me.
I disagree. So, I understand that that is difficult. But with this president, I believe reporters need to call him out when he lies. And so let's go back to the debates. And he lied in the debates any number of times. I think it's the duty of the moderator, when you know it's a lie, say it. And
as long as you do that across the board.
Absolutely.
So when Chuck Schumer lies, you would call him
absolutely.
Out too.
And
as long as you're doing it fairly.
Sure, absolutely. And Democrats lie.
But as long as you're doing it fairly.
Yeah, Democrats lie, you know, they both sides
they all lie.
But Trump just does it to an unusual degree and frequency.
Sure.
And on things that are really, you know, some really big things. And for a purpose. And you know, so I think it's important for reporters to say that. So especially in the,
I'm going to weigh in just one thing to follow up on what Bob said, what you've been saying. You know, during the debates, CNN put an enormous team together to do the reality checking of those debates and feed that stuff back to not only the anchors, but also to do the immediate after the debate reality checks. The amount of effort that went into that and chasing down every detail and coming up with backup to do that was 30 people up till 4 in the morning on debate nights. And I would get in just dragging my sorry rear end and then have to get up the next morning to get back in the office for that 9 o'clock editorial meeting. That's the logistical challenge you have in an environment where the claims come fast and furious and the ability to keep up is really difficult. That was an exaggerated moment because so many of them came during the debate on both sides. To do that on an ongoing basis for a news organization is a monumental commitment of time and resources, which a lot of organizations like the New York Times, keeping its track, are doing. But for the little paper in Conyers or the television station in Atlanta, it becomes really difficult because they don't have the resources to do that. And that's a huge challenge to the point you made.
Somebody of the greatest software organization will tell you it's an iron.
Artificial intelligence.
Well, that's what Snopes is. To some degree. I'm curious, there's somebody here who actually had a big hand in inventing the World Wide Web. Sam Gassel.
Wait, is Al Gore here?
No, Sam Gassel created the code for one of the very first web browsers that made
it possible. No. I put CNN on the web. Everyone else went there.
I worked on that early mosaic software that allowed people to get to the web. Do you see technical solutions to this?
Mulling them? It comes down to the humans, and it does come down to that logistical effort You know, if in advance of the debates you had collated, you know, all the things they were likely to speak about and the ways in which so there's all that effort in advance, plus the real time, plus getting anyone to listen to it, which actually is a nice lead into the I'm not sure whether it's a softball or a screwball that I'm going to throw you here, but it's well meant.
Page views, we would get 18 to 20 million page views on those reality.
Yeah, that's a good net.
Huge number.
That's a good net. That's a good, I didn't know that number, so that's a good
net. What do people here think about the social media platforms to take that issue a little bit further? Should they take a position, should they try to police what's on their sites more than they do now?
You know, at the end of the day, there's still the First Amendment. And I get really bothered when I watch universities that have journalism schools in them, and they're saying you can't say certain phrases on campus. And the only time you can say what's on your mind is in this 4x4 box off in a remote corner of the campus is the only time you can speak your mind. And I think we're developing a culture where, you know, we're nipping the Fourth Amendment. I mean, the First Amendment, we won't have the First Amendment anymore if we keep on that course. And I think, you know, we're creating, or you want to create that on social media. And I think Zuckerberg has come out and said, you know, am I supposed to be the arbiter of speech, of what is acceptable and what's not acceptable?
So, one thing, I think it was the Kathleen Hall Jameson article you mentioned, one of the things that and other studies that I've read have found is that particularly through social media, which has that social trust in it, that once a lie is seeded, even repeating it to debunk it tends to enhance it and make it more plausible and make it more believed in the future, which is, along with our colleague Brooks Jackson, has been working on fact check and so on forever. And the enterprise is not taking for some reason. So my question for you is there maybe a rhetorical change that needs to happen? Because when CNN puts on the same panel its anchor, its reporter, its professional analyst and its partisans who are not subject to the same standards, which it was your job to enforce, but they're not all subject to the same standard, but they're all the same panel. And so there's no question of, hey, that's a ragged, I didn't know about the ragged
right
margin, but there's no question of that.
So it undermines
what you're doing.
That comes back to the issue of clarity. Where is the boundary analysis and punditry, and that's become blurred, not just on CNN, but in many other places, because they're all sitting in one panel.
Right. Fox viewers can't tell when the news ends.
Figure it out, even with a font on the bottom of the screen.
You know, but they've got the same font.
The same graphics package.
Yeah.
Fox viewers can't tell when the news ends and the commentary begins.
I first wanted to apologize for walking out after Feed the Meter, but I'd like to say this. I think some of the issue that we're having is that the citizens should be able to distinguish themselves between what's fake. You go check another source, you know. I think it's sort of an indictment of our educational system, the lack of teaching civics and knowing the three branches of government and was it for the state and why it's there and those things. So I think that's somewhat of an indictment of our education system. I think that some of the fake news also is contributing to the fact that our media has become so corporatized. And back in the day, media didn't have to earn money.
Well, it always had to
But you're talking about community standards, you're talking about, I know the FCC doesn't control, the cable part, but then there's still some things that I think, the fairness doctrine, all those things that have kind of fallen away has somewhat to be contributed to all of these issues that we're talking about now. And you'll never be able to combat fake news if it's all about the social impact that, you know, the person, how they begin to, how they filter it themselves.
Well, during the time that you were talking about all Americans pretty much getting their news from common sources, there were only three national broadcast networks with three different sets of anchors.
And Walter Cronkite was the most trusted man in America.
Yeah.
Man.
And now you have a huge, what's the population of the United States?
320 million.
So we've got 324 million people on the web writing stuff.
I think we have time for one more. Jerry, did you have a...
I had a question kind of about the enabling function of the media in perpetuating fake news. Because I guess in my mind, a random tweet from Trump at 2 o'clock in the morning is not news, especially when it's going to be contradicted 12 hours later. But that tends to be the lead story on so many news outlets, analyzing what those 12 words or 14 words meant.
Right.
And it becomes a story because
But first of all, he has millions of followers, so
some of them are real.
Not as many, not all of them are real. But the reason, so Trump gets so much coverage, and this was true during the campaign, so he got way more coverage than any other Republican candidate, even in the general election, more coverage than and a lot of it was negative, right? Because he attracts ratings. I mean, that's it. I mean, you cover Trump and you get ratings. And you know, that's what it's about.
As we're running out of time, there's a question I've missed back to the back.
Yeah, well, the one thing I wanted to share with y'all about how fake news can be. I don't know if you remember when the attorney, Trent Quinn, got shot in Midtown several months ago. They started a fake news campaign about her that she had that morning gone to get information from the district court and she got shot by Islamic terrorists. And so people were posting this and it made me angry because I know her actually. And so I had to say, this is a lie, this is not true. Like, I know her, she works for UPS as an in-house lawyer. Like, she's not going, like they were, you know, saying that she was asking about the interstate collapse and that's why she got murdered. And it was like a crazy story that made no sense, but people were believing it and sharing it. And one of my good friends who is a smart, liberal, educated lawyer was like, do you know about this? And I go, this is a total lie. I know this woman. So this is like how scary, like smart, intelligent, educated people can be influenced by.
The story about the CMC.
Yes, the Seth guy.
And that story came, and he was responsible for giving the WikiLeaks, the
WikiLeaks, yeah.
The email to the media, and told a lot.
It's terrifying. It's terrifying.
And what do you believe? Yeah. What do you believe on the right, but also on the far left. So there were a lot of Bernie Sanders supporters who wanted to. Because it fit in with their kind of notion of that the Clinton campaign was corrupt, and they would actually kill someone. Yeah.
But I think we were making a valid point that it is through the sourcing that went to your friend who's a well-educated lawyer, someone forwarded that to her, which gave it the credibility that she read it and then came to you and said, did you see this? And it, in her passing along to you, if you didn't know anything about the case, you would have said, this is a well-educated lawyer.
Right.
She's sharing this. For all of us, sharing carefully is a huge prophylactic for the spread of this stuff. So there we go. Use your prophylactics.
Was there one more?
Kind of one. I think on credibility. I'm the self-serving politician, and I have a degree in journalism, so I'm twice bitten on this thing. But I'm a huge First Amendment advocate in Georgia government. But one thing I see is, and I grew up in the era of broadcast giants and print media giants that could have been elected president of the United States if he wanted to. Walter Cronkite probably could have. But one thing I see is now we have to have the experts on the news, and we have to have the expert analysis. And then when you see James Clapper, who's lied to Congress two times under oath, and David Petraeus, who had been under the rank of colonel, would be in Leavenworth doing 20 years right now. You know, and you're seeing quotes from the Huff Post, and the editor of Huff Post wrote this blatantly biased piece against Donald Trump. I mean, openly saying, let me tell you why I hate this man. And then they get quoted in major newspapers as a source. And I'm just wondering, how do you clean that up?
Well,
because that's why people are clicking the channel.
Probably will think back to Melvin Melcher since you trained. For those of you who didn't go to journalism school, there's a theory about the layers of journalism. It was originally put out there by Melvin Melcher, who was a professor from Long Island who went to work at Columbia. And I actually use it a lot within CNN and have expanded on it a lot. I won't get into my 1 hour lecture on this, but the three basic concepts are, layer one journalism is what you learn from the news release, the news conference, the police blotter, a train wreck has occurred, a plane has crashed, the basics that a story occurred. Layer two journalism is holding the officials accountable for what they said in the news conference, what they said in the tweet, why did the plane crash, what are the underpinnings of the story. Then layer three is analysis and opinion. Well, it's very easy to have an opinion. I don't want to fly Thunderbolt Airlines because they fly old planes, or that politician is corrupt and you see it here in this reporting. Well, layer one and layer three are very easy for social media to do. Anybody can forward a tweet based on what the president has said or forward a news conference, and it's easy for the officials to go over the public. It's very easy to do the analysis and opinion. Anybody in their pajamas can do analysis and opinion. But serious journalism, that layer two enterprise reporting where you're doing accountability journalism, is really hard, requires a big investment. And that's where great news organizations thrive. And for the news organizations that fall back on the opinion and just doing the layer one reporting, that's where we're losing our credibility with the public. In order to maintain that credibility, you've got to really drill down on that enterprise reporting where you're challenging and holding accountable.
How many journalists are in this room?
Well, so there were several, but they have slipped out.
I would just challenge journalists to start having these conversations with communities. This has become an academic exercise, but I kind of feel sometimes we are in a room of taxi drivers when Uber's outside, right? And then there's I think that we're not in a position right now to, like, the academic debate around this is awesome, but there are people's lives that are being affected by this stuff on the ground. We can get back to the nuances of journalism at the national level and all of that, but I'm really concerned that information is being withheld from people in a real way, and I'm concerned that the people who are in charge of changing that aren't fully seeing what the root of the problem is. It's not that they don't trust you because your subject predicate whatnot is not in order.
Yes.
They don't trust you because you're still lying. Like, I think that you have to stop. We have to stop lying to people. I also think that newsrooms need to start looking like the people that they're reporting about. And when you look at actually who works in media and how you can actually get into working in media, if you don't sound white, if you don't look white, you're not going to be able to move up the ranks without a lot of pressure, or if you create your own publication. There has been a huge discriminatory practice within this field. We don't recognize it as an industry. So I think if you really want to get to the heart of it, it's messy, ugly, human garbage. Like, it's just really bad stuff that has piled up. This is a shift in power. data is power. And when you were talking about Thomas Jefferson, and you when you talk about Walter Cronkite, the one thing they had was power. They had the power to deliver the information when I wanted to give it to you, how I want to give it to you, and when I, and how much of it I want to give to you. Today, now the power has shifted back to people. And your reports and your data and the polls that you're doing, we don't feel it reflects us. Maybe it does, and we're making that connection because we're not smart enough or whatever that might be. But truth is, a lot of what's being reported on doesn't feel and look like us. And I'm concerned that the approach that we're still taking is just, you know, lipstick on a pig. And I really hope that we can start to change the way newsrooms look. So that we can also report on people's lives as they actually are, as opposed to how we see them. We become voyeurs and voyeurs. And I think that that's something that I hope will change. And I think if there's a young kid that wants to, of color, that wants to be a journalist, we need to make that pathway a lot easier for them to get there so that they can be in the newsroom helping you fact check.
That's great, and I agree with you, but don't think that that's gonna cause Trump supporters find the news more.
Bro, you're so concerned about Trump supporters, man. Like, I get that, dude. Like, I get it. Trump supporters are
because you got to like the president.
I think that, like, English Avenue looks the damn same under Obama as it does under Trump. Like, go walk the streets of this city. It does. People's lives don't feel different. So they are looking for a way to just be able to live their lives, not be able to discern between your fake and real news. The majority of people are not clickbait. The majority of people are struggling on a daily basis. They're not getting online to check whether it is that you gave them what's going on. But a lot of people in a city like Atlanta and other cities that look like Atlanta, digital divides are so huge that just accessing a computer is a privilege. So I think we're concerned about a privileged problem. And I know that it's an increasing problem. I'm not saying it's not a problem. I'm just saying that changing the way you deliver the news is not gonna get to the root of it. And I don't think people are concerned about Trump if you're worried about losing your home the next day. I just don't think so.
You ought to be concerned because what Trump's trying to do and what his party are trying to do is gonna have extremely negative effects. If they repeal the Affordable Care Act, if they do away with these protections that were enacted for borrowers and for people who are buying on credit, believe me, it's going to hurt those communities that you're talking about.
I don't disagree with you.
It matters.
I don't disagree with you. This is a president that I believed, the president before is the one I believed in deeply, right? I believe that the Affordable Care Act is insanely important. What I'm trying to say is that message is not translating by telling people you better care about it. This, because the way that we're presenting this information to people is not actually recognizing where they're at. It's recognizing, we've already said, you're a Trump supporter. You're a Hillary supporter. You're an ignorant millennial. You're whatever those things are. It's affecting the way that we're communicating with each other.
People,
and it's
people
making
are
young
getting
people
it.
Tune out.
People actually are getting it because if you look at the polling on something like the Affordable Care Act and repealing it, it's overwhelmingly unpopular. What they're trying to do is very unpopular. And it's unpopular because people understand that what it would do is take away their health insurance and take away their health care.
The road to hell is paved with people with good intent by people with good intentions. I agree with you. I'm just saying the root of the problem is different than what we're making it out to
be. This is a very large conversation.
Our two honorees this year are recently departed Judge Marvin Shoub, who's a federal district judge in Atlanta. So we're thrilled to honor him. And then I'm sure not a stranger to folks in the room. Sally Yates is our secretary. So look forward to, hope to see you there. November 30th is our public interest happy hour, and that's going to be at the Angels. So hope to see you there too. Thank you so much for coming.
Something else.